So I'm going to talk about credit market, I'm going to talk about entrepreneurship, and I'm going to talk about economic development. And it is contemporary issues in the sense that we are going to talk about the world as we see around us right now. Of course, there is a historical element, so it is not a question of ignoring history, but these issues may have cropped up much more substantially in last few decades. They have continued to be enduring. They have continued to be emerging. So I'm going to pick on those issues in terms of which we can associate ourselves to the contemporary situations. Okay. So of course, this is a lecture on, so the first part of the lecture is credit market imperfection and poverty trap. I will try to sort of divide it equally between, you know, 2 hours and so on. I think that's what my quota is. But there can be a little bit of an overlap that has to be adjusted with. So what is the motivation and outline? Credit market is critical for development, and imperfect credit market is a serious constraint. So unfortunately, in economics textbooks, be it in micro or in macro, you know, take fundamental textbooks that with which we start in our undergraduate studies, we never say anything about how economic activities are financed. Now, why we don't say that? Is it not? It is not true that the stalwarts who have actually, introduced the subject did not know about it. But there is a presumption. The presumption is that whatever finance is required, it will be freely available. And hence, there is no need to analyze financial conditions. So this is the main reason. That is, finance is not a constraining factor for any economic activity that we undertake. And that's where the intervention should come in, by saying that finance is a critical factor for almost all activities that we undertake in the market. So credit market is critical for the markets to function, and definitely it is critical for development, because ultimately we talk about growth, education, investments in health, investments in education, investments in technology. And so financial conditions, credit market, these become very important factors. And what is imperfect credit market? Imperfect credit market fundamentally means that it is not perfect credit market. So you have to understand perfect credit market at a given interest, which we cannot manipulate. Any economic agent can borrow and lend as much as she wants. That is perfect credit market. That is, at the ongoing interest, I can give as much loan as I want to give. I can take as much loan as I want to take. And when I cannot do that, that is the imperfect credit market. So it can be because of several reasons, but whenever this particular statement I cannot make, that at a given interest rate I can do anything, that's an imperfect credit market. A source of finance in the developing world, as a source of finance in the developing world, the banking system is far more powerful than share or bond markets. You see, in the developing world, we try to develop share market, that is markets where shares are traded, or bond markets where there are borrowing lending instruments such as piece of paper on which individual or corporates or governments promise to pay the lender certain fixed sum of money. But all this said and done, the majority of finance comes from the banks. And in a country like India, it is from the public sector banks. So therefore, credit market and the relationship with the banks is very important to understand. Share market, bond market, we can actually think of as separate stories, and I shall not devote much to that, but all of them are consequences of imperfect credit market. Because whatever activity I want to undertake today, I may not have resources to do that. But I know that if I take that activity, undertake it, I'm going to pay back somebody who finances it. And all economic activities, well, most of it, yield benefits in future. So there is a time gap between when we invest and when we get our return. So who is going to bear that risk? Who is going to pay me that money? And that gives us different ways of financing this, of which the banking system is very important. Therefore, it is essential that we study the basic theoretical models that capture the relationship between credit market and economic prosperity. Theory is essential because you want to know the mechanisms. So it is not only that you run a bunch of regressions, because you might get excited by results which are really very, very trivial and obvious, and you can get excited by results which you cannot explain. Mechanisms are very important to policymakers because they want to understand, if I have a policy A in financial market, how that is going to impact on the economy. Okay, so we continue with the motivation and outline. There will be two parts of the lecture. The first is about basic understanding of closed economic issues related to labor market and poverty trap, employment, poverty trap, human capital accumulation, etc. These are very popular topics in development, and I shall show how very simple way of modeling imperfect credit market and banking system or lack of it can affect these operations of labor market and can perpetuate poverty traps by not allowing the entrepreneurship to grow or not allowing human capital to be formed. The second one is about open economic issues. This is very, very contemporary and current, because the second one is about open economic issues with trade and capital flow. The reference for the first part are given at the end of the first set of slides. Now, these are reading materials. I'm not going to talk about reading materials now because I want to because these are all given in your documents that I have asked the organizers to upload. And so basically, as a background, you can read Debraj Rai's famous undergraduate textbook on development economics, or Kaushik Bosu's analytical development economics, MIT Press textbooks. These are backgrounds, and I hope that some of you have them, or some of you have read part of it. And the second part would be actually from some work that we have been doing, and I think that this will give you an idea of what are at least a few new research questions that you can talk about, particularly in the context of our country. So I'm going to talk about first credit market imperfection as I see it in the occupational choice issues, in poverty trap, and eventually in production and trade. And I shall be using a very simple characterization of heterogeneous agents in the economy. Studying development economics or economic development, whatever it is, first you have to admit that you have to get out of the artifact of textbooks by saying that agents are all homogeneous. They are not. Now, intrinsically, agents can be heterogeneous because their intellectual or cognitive endowments are very different. That is possible. But intrinsic difference, which is inherently in terms of biophysical differences, we are not considering in this paper. But we cannot deny the fact that there are heterogeneities to that extent. But the heterogeneity which becomes very important and critical for credit market is amount of capital or amount of wealth or amount of asset that somebody can put into production. And as you know, that poor people do not have it. Very poor do not have it. Some poor people have something. Then, we can classify the distribution of population according to the inherited wealth or wealth from the past periods or some sort of liquidity that we have in our pocket. So all of this I will amalgamate into a single concept of capital, wealth, liquidity and so on. I am going to talk about and only about financial capital in the sense that I'm not going to talk about fixed investments which can actually continue for, you know, continue for many periods and give you results after a substantial period. I am more or less will consider a paradigm of present and future, and we shall take between present and future a single period. So that will be sufficient for you to understand what is going on. So workers versus entrepreneurs. So if you are a worker, you are not investing. You are an employee, you are employed. If you are an entrepreneur, then you are investing. And in total population, I index with a real number that lies between 0 and 1. We call it Z. That belongs to 0. So any point on that real line of 0 and 1, one class of population, or I would probably say that one person, one individual, that I shall denote. And each has KZ amount of capital. So KZ amount means each person has a capital stock, a wealth stock of K, which is basically Z specific, and K prime is greater than 0. So from 0 to 1, it is poor to rich. That's how I classify. Now banks, as we know, is borrowing rate is greater than lending rate. Now that's another feature of imperfect credit market, because the lenders, you know, are actually earning a premium from the borrowers. That's how they make positive profits. Now you might say that perfect credit market does not exist because that does not give any special return to the financial intermediaries who are undertaking this intermediation. If they are undertaking the intermediation, they expect certain return, and if the deposit rate is not lower than the borrowing rate, the lending rate is actually deposit rate, let's say, but so the borrowing rate is not greater than lending rate, then the banks do not get any extra money. That's their income. So we take a very simple production function. So X is a function of labor. So what is the production process? The production process is, suppose I want to be an entrepreneur, I employ labor at the beginning of the day, the laborers at the beginning of the day. So for the whole day, I have to pay, and in the beginning, the whole day I have to pay them the wage, because if they do not get the wage, they cannot work. And then at the end of the day, I get my profits. So if that is the case, then somebody has to finance this gap, this time gap. So I have my own capital, my own wealth, which I can put into production, and I can borrow from the bank. And in fact, since I am going to talk about the borrowing and lending from the bank, I would actually eventually assume that there are, you know, these, because otherwise, you know, this is really needed, but it's not relevant. That is, you know, if I have somebody who is not borrowing from the bank, he or she can remain sort of in the as a black box somewhere. But I'm not going to talk about that. Now, 3.1 is a very standard but very critical kind of a concept. It's called no default constraint. What is no default constraint? The left hand side tells you that, or right hand side, let's take the right hand side first. I have taken money from the bank, so I have paid interest rate. Now all through my analysis, capital R will mean 1 plus R, small r will mean 1 plus small r. So because I would always have to write 1 plus R and 1 plus small r, I have not written that. So that's understandable. That is subsumed in the process. So if you look at the right hand side, I produce something, you know, and sell it. So this you can actually, I'm not bringing in prices. So this is like a revenue. Then I pay back to the bank because I borrowed an amount B. And because I put in my wealth into the system, my capital into the system, I could have put it in a fixed deposit. That would have given me an interest rate of 1 plus small r. So I'm foregoing that. So your cost of capital is opportunity cost of your money and the borrowed amount that the bank is charging an interest rate. So if this is the case, then right hand side is the incentive constraint for an honest borrower. He produces, he pays back to the bank, and he makes money. The left hand side, that suppose I am a dishonest borrower. So after I take the money from the bank, I don't pay back. Then we bring in this concept of a penalty that the bank can charge it. So Q is the probability that the bank will audit in case I default. And theta KZ is a fraction of the asset it will take. Now, sorry, theta is not a fraction. Theta is a part of the asset, because you can see that theta will depend on something, but we'll take it as something which is related to the asset. Now you can see that maximum borrowing that I can do is given by the amount in 3.2. If you compare this right and left, because if I don't have a substantial amount of capital, the bank cannot punish me. The bank can go to the court, but the court will say that, you know, that this guy is bankrupt. So more I have, more is the bank willing me to give as loan. This is the paradox about which development finance has talked about in a big way. Consequence of that is microfinance. That is, I would like to borrow and become an entrepreneur if and only if I don't have asset. If I had an asset, then I could have borrowed easily. So loan is needed for people who do not have collateral, do not have wealth. But if I don't have wealth, then the bank does not give me loan. That's why the formal sector banking, it's difficult for the formal sector banking to make a dent. And the governments have to make an extra effort to open bank accounts and tell the banks to give loans to people who do not have, collaterals and so on. And collateral-less lending system became very important in modern day development finance, like microfinance, Grameen banks, and institutions like Grameen banks, and people like Muhammad Yunus and others who have actually spearheaded such initiative. Because without having wealth or liquidity or capital that the bank can grab when I am not paying back, the bank needs some other kind of capital on which bank can rely, and thus emerge the notion of social capital. That is, the bank knows a community. So community lending is, so member of a community can actually pay back the loan, because the community acts as the watchdog. And the community is made to believe that, or the community knows that the members of the community will be liable, because if this guy does not pay back, the members don't get loans. That's how Grameen banks started emerging. And these microfinance institutions are now emerging as big banks. The case study of Bandhan Bank in India is very important in this context. So for the formal sector banking, you need some wealth, call it collateral or whatever. So whatever I have, that is my KZ, plus whatever the bank gives, and I'm assuming that everybody borrows, so bank can in principle give me the maximum amount, and so I get the maximum amount, which is V bar Z. That gives me the initial finance that I can spend on the workers. So this must be the total wage bill that I can pay for. If this is the case, then we can say that total amount of number of people I can employ is this total amount of finance by the wage rate. And look here, for a different reason, the demand for employment is a downward sloping function of the wage, given the amount of finance. See, when we study microeconomics and you study, for example, how the farms are going to choose optimal quantity of labor, then what you see is that we have a production function, the banks maximize profits, so we use marginal productivity condition, and therefore we hire people, and as W falls, then I can hire more because my marginal revenue increases and my marginal productivity drops up to W. That's how the demand function for labor behaves, and that's how we derive the demand function for labor. Here, the demand function for labor comes from a rectangular hyperbola, because W into LDZ is a given amount of finance. So this is like a rectangular hyperbola, which is basically a downward sloping line. And then you can find out from there a demand for labor, which is totally determined by the extent of finance. And now we make a heroic assumption, which I don't think heroic, which makes sense. And it would make sense to understand what is going on, is that we assume that from zero to Z tilde, people don't have any capital. That is, these are really, really poor people. And from Z tilde to one, people have some capital of their own. So basically, you can also see that that what does credit constraint does in the system? See, what is your marginal cost of borrowing? Suppose you, there was no credit constraint, but you have to borrow from the bank, and there is no credit rationing, because this is credit rationing. I cannot borrow any amount. So the bank just says, no, you can borrow any amount you want, but you have to pay me this borrowing rate, right? So then my marginal cost of borrowing would be actually capital R, because I want to employ one extra labor, then I know that I have to pay him W into 1 plus capital R, which is W into R. And my marginal productivity of labor is X prime. So that would be equal then. Now you can see that X prime LD, if you put it in production function, that must be greater than the number of people that you are employing, which means you want to employ more. Had there been no credit rationing and your marginal, that is, you could employ anybody, provided you were willing to pay the bank capital R, then you would follow a marginal productivity condition given here in this slide as X prime LD equal to WR. But now you can't employ those people because you are borrowing the amount, the credit, the quantity constraint. So credit rationing is on. Therefore, X prime LD has to be greater than this amount. So if given an opportunity, you are going to employ more. So everyone borrows in this system. That is, people from whoever wants to be an entrepreneur has to borrow, because everybody faces this credit rationing. And now there is some simple this thing, labor supply. Those who are not entrepreneurs, they will become laborers. So in the real line from 0 to 1, a chunk of it from 0 to Z tilde, those people are laborers. So that is labor supply. And we have known what is labor demand, because if LDZ is labor demand, we just integrate between Z tilde and 1. That is sum of labor demand, basically. And we can actually take from the equation here, that is labor demand, we can substitute the value that we have here to here, and we can get this result. And we know that labor demand is a downward sloping function of wage rate, and Z tilde is independent of W. See, it is not that people do not want to be entrepreneurs because wage rates are high. It is just by assumption that they don't have liquidity, they don't have collateral, so they have to be employees. Bank will not pay them loan. And the employers, each of them can employ some people. Of course, the richest one will employ maximum number because they have maximum amount of finance, and the poorest one will actually employ the minimum number. So with that, we can then draw a demand function and a supply function. Simple. There is a demand function, and the supply function is vertical because it does not depend on W. Now, for example, think of that there are two countries, two regions, where at one region Z tilde is higher, which means there are more poor people and less richer people. So it will affect the demand and supply conditions simultaneously. This is the analytical interesting point of credit market rationing. That is, those who cannot be entrepreneurs have to be workers because they have to survive. So if I cannot be entrepreneur, then the labor supply curve will shift to the right because there will be excess supply of labor. And if I'm not, I cannot be entrepreneur, then demand for labor will fall. So that region having a greater Z tilde, more poor people, will also have lower wage. Why they would have lower wage? Because there will be more employees and less employer. So they are poor because they don't have sufficient amount of wealth, and they would perpetuate poverty. So it is poverty which leads to poverty. Very interesting is that in the standard labor demand, you go to your textbook and you forget about finance. In the standard labor demand, yes, you can have a fixed labor supply and you have a fixed labor demand. There is no way that your labor supply, when it shifts, like, you know, for some reason, you know, population increases, etc., you know, why there will be an increase in demand or decrease in labor demand? Nothing. No factor is common except wage rate, which is determined in equilibrium. Here, finance affects both ways. It affects your supply, it affects your demand. And this is the first entry into the theory of poverty trap. It is the first entry that if you are in a poverty, you tend to be in poverty. If you are rich, then you tend to be in rich. And if the system is poor, then the system remains poor. So this is the first port of entry, because we shall go to more complex scenarios when we go to human capital accumulation. But fundamentally, the way you would understand is that finance is actually creating this kind of anomalies from the supply and demand side. So income of the rich. This is just to show that when wage rate falls, the income of the rich will go up. Now, this is clearly done. This is simple. A calculation, x of lz minus kzr. I have broken up the borrowing, which is the total labor employment value that you get from finance, wlz minus your own wealth. And then you find out how this entrepreneur's income, the rich people's income, will be changing with w. Then you have these two terms. See, the first term we have argued why this is positive, because you really want to, you know, employ more, which you cannot. So that is positive. I mean, and the DLDZ DW is less than zero. So this is negative. This is negative. So if W goes down, then your YR will go up. The rich people's income will go up. Another point I just would tell you, that economic theory, or for development finance, or for that matter, any part of economic theory, you should not take any conclusion as if you understand that, because you understand in your mind. There is a big problem with the students and researchers and scholars, that we take certain results as if, oh, this must happen. No, that type of conclusion makes you complacent. That type of conclusion makes you absolutely, you know, sometimes absolutely ignorant. So if I tell you that if the wage rate goes down, the people would be richer, you know, the richer people would be rich. Now, I would always ask you that the framework that I'm using, you have to prove in there. Because the framework I have used, I have developed a picture of reality. and I want my answer in this picture of reality. I don't want what realism is there in your mind. Actually, teacher should not care. Most likely the teacher will do is make those two realities converge to some extent. But the way we think that we understand reality can be all wrong. So whenever there is a proposition, there is a formal proof of that proposition. However insignificant that proposition is. So the rich people's income goes up when wage rate drops. And of course, the poor people's income goes down when the wage rate drops. So not only poverty increases, but inequality also increases. Now, to start with, if we have poverty, it leads to poverty. Start with, if we have inequality, because there is inequality of wealth and distribution, it leads to inequality. That's what we have proved in simple terms with the credit market finance and this. And basically, if you consider now, this is static kind of a model. There can be dynamics because investment is a dynamic concept. So today, in 2010 or 2020, I have saved some money from, we have suggested that suppose your wealth level is the same, but where one place Z tilde is greater than one is, you know, in the other Z tilde 1t is greater than Z tilde 2t, then we have shown that W1t is less than W2t, but everybody is working and they can save something. So if they save, they can actually add to their capital stock. So there is no reason to believe that workers of today cannot be entrepreneurs of tomorrow. That is number one. That is possible. So basically, now food for thought is, in the structure I have given to you, you can go home or you can go to, you know, you can relax and in your spare moments, you can actually think about this, that the process of saving is always badly affected because there is a minimum consumption requirement. So just because you are earning, it might not mean that you can save much. So that is one point that you can bring into this. And you can see that the dynamics might not give you something, different. Dynamics may not give you something different because your static situation is perpetuated because you tend to eat away most of it. You can't save and you can't really gather capital. And if you cannot gather capital, the bank will not give you loan. Non-convexity in production function. This is a bit more complicated, but I'll discuss that later. Now, non-convexity is like you have increasing returns to scale. So if you cannot invest a significant amount, your production does not start. So there is indivisibility. You know, you can have this kind of poverty perpetuating for a considerable length of time because you are saving. That's not enough. And then try to understand that anomalies like that, how that is going to impact within societies or across societies. Now, there are papers which you can dig out from internet and so on. But I think fundamentally, if you understand that what is the basic problem, then you can focus on your saving investment hypothesis, your that those doses of realism, the nitty-gritties that you see around you, and try to plug into this system and see how this system actually functions. Now, another point which I have not written here, but which is drawing a lot of attention now, is how people behave in terms of their consumption. It's not very easy to say that we are in a world of homo economicus. We have all the same and we behave in similar fashion. In fact, one such anomaly is economics of status. That is, if we are really geared to conspicuous consumption, we will less than savers. We tend to consume away everything. Now, just to give an idea, consumption of China is at least 10% less than India's consumption in GDP. Because Chinese saving rate for many periods used to be 50. Saving rate actually did not cross 30%. So you see, the consumption share of China as a percent of GDP is much lower than India. And not have any time series statistics of our household income, or even annual statistics. We have only consumption expenditure. And we have very little data on household level actual debts. And you will find that even people having reasonable income, reasonable in the sense that people are out of poverty and so on, etc., they might be spending through the nose. And there is a huge literature that has developed, and some of you must have read Abhijit Banerjee and Duflo's book on poor economics, or their article in Economic Perspectives. And many people have said that there is significant cross-country evidence that the pattern of consumption by low-income people are not what proper economic theory predicts. And the question is that if my consumption is significant, then compared to China and other countries, then actually my saving rates would be much lower and capital formation would be lower. I'm going to talk a bit about a topic of tangential interest later, but so that part I have not said. So basically, you can think of anomalies and you can put in the simplest model that I have developed as an abstraction and see how this thing change. So you can yourself see how those changes are going to impact on this initial poverty's impact on ultimate poverty, initial inequality's impact on ultimate inequality. So credit market imperfection and human capital accumulation, that's what we're going to study. Actually, I have written Galor and Zaira's paper 1993, which is very well developed in Kaushik Basu's textbook very nicely. But there is also a paper by Banerjee and Newman in 1992. But I think that's a bit more difficult to follow than Galor and Zaira. But actually, once you read Galor and Zaira and you go through the literature, for example, the references I have given on Mukherjee Ray's paper on persistent inequality and so on, you will see the references. The Mukherjee and Ray give much more recent references and references to other papers. So I have not given you all kinds of papers to look at, but I shall tell you the fundamental reasons that traps can emerge. And very interestingly, as a demonstration, the solo model is sufficient, that I believe. Those who have studied Solow's very well-known seminal work on growth theory, the Solow's growth model, then you know that Solow's growth model is described by this simple diagram. I have made this diagram sort of not really concave all through, but I will come to that. A concave FK function, where small k is capital to labor ratio, and S is the rate of savings, which is constant. So S of FK is a concave function of small k that intersects with NK. N is the population rate of growth, so that the steady state condition of Solow model is small SFK equal to NK, or small SFK by K equal to N. Small SFK by K is nothing but rate of growth of capital, and N is rate of growth of population. So that's how this intersection point gives you the Solovian equilibrium. And that equilibrium tells you that in steady state, your Y by L remains the same. Y grows at the same rate as L or K, and your K by L remains the same. And there is this unique steady state to which you will convert. So you start from any K, then because you're on the left of the steady state, if you're K is to the left of the steady state, your growth of capital is greater than growth of labor. In that case, you go towards right. On the right, on the right side of the steady state, you come to the left. That's how the Solovian model is determined. Now you see, the does not have this kind of convex and concave production function. But suppose you have non-convexity, which is very realistic. That is, although I started this curve from zero, I could have started this, actually I should have started this curve from some segment of the horizontal axis by saying that you cannot start production significant amount, up to some amount, not significant, but up to some amount. And then what happens is, actually, initially the production may rise very fast before the diminishing returns actually sets in. So you can have a convex production function, then you go to a concave production function. And whenever there is three intersections, that's a general theorem, that is, if you have three equilibria in any economic model, then the middle equilibria would be unstable and the corner equilibria or the polar equilibria will be stable. And here is a case where when the vertical line should have been little to the left, because I mean vertical line is on the second intersection point. You see, if you are to the left of that K, then your population growth is greater than capital growth of capital. So you will revert to zero. If you are to the right of that K, of the middle point, then you will go to the corner, the polar point, where you will earn a lot of income. And both this zero point and the extreme point on the right, both of them are stable points. The extreme point on the right is a solo point, and the extreme point on the left is a zero corner point. The middle one is unstable. So if you have increasing returns to scale, which is you have a convex production function, that is, more you give output, more capital starts increasing to some extent. Then with convexity, you have a chance that if you start with a very low capital stock, then eventually it will not survive, because the population, the system will not survive, because the system cannot match the population growth. On the other hand, if you just could cross this critical point, somebody could give you a big push. This is like a big push theory. Somebody could give you a big push so that you move to the right of the middle point, then you can go to the stable equilibrium. So credit market imperfection can generate non-convexity type outcome. So credit market imperfection can generate non-convexity type outcome. Now, the credit market imperfection, that credit market imperfection can generate non-convexity of outcome, that we shall discuss more rigorously, and in the context of human capital accumulation. Now, you see, in a way, being an entrepreneur or going to school for education, for that matter, to higher education, this is almost analytical terms. In analytical terms, it is almost similar. Why? Because you have some money in your pocket. You borrow some money in your pocket because you want to invest today and you want to get a return tomorrow. This is the story that is true for both standard investment for production and standard investment for human capital. So the story of human capital accumulation, as we shall develop, could also be a story of entrepreneurial capital. And there are certain references that I think a very holistic, very interesting theoretical work is by Mukherjee and Ray. I guess it is in 2003. Economic Perspectives, by studies and by telling you why, or paradox, that poor do not invest in insurance or in their own family financial security, but they go for extravagant consumption. And it is not it's not an example that is pathological or paradoxical, because it may be paradox so far as economic theory is concerned, but it's not a paradox if you look around us. Now, Now, people have said, you know, there are, before I go into human capital accumulation, I really want to talk a bit about this, because this is not, I'll have time to develop, but I want to ingrain something in your minds so that, you know, at that, I will tell you that that literature is evolving. It is drawn from the behavioral literature in experimental economics, but it is more like analytical behavioral economics, because we try to theorize some of the human behaviors that we do not actually practice or cultivate in our textbooks. So the question is that, and people in the context of particularly in the context of conspicuous consumption, that is, why people go for conspicuous consumption. And this is true for high income, middle income, low income, it does not matter. And there have been social, experiments at the social circuits, also in economic circuits. And people have proved that this is true. And people do it because they want to prove something in the society, their worth. And this is so pervasive. And this can affect your consumption, your savings, everything. And it has implications. Now, people might say that, why do you point out to the poor? We also do it. Because if I have extra income to do it, it does not affect my poverty. It does not affect my nutrition. It does not affect certain things which I need necessarily. But if I am hovering around poverty and I engage in extravagant consumption, that may have long-run implications. I may not have resources to put my kids to school, or even if you put kids to school, they can't go to higher education. I may engage in activities which do not protect me from future problems in health or education and so on. And then we are basically anyway exposed to a lot of disasters and so on. So the question is that the government will have some responsibilities, the government will intervene. But even if when government intervenes, if there is certain behavioral complexities, you can actually end up having situations like people are becoming richer but malnourished. People are getting higher income, but their nutritional levels are not increasing that much. You know, so there are many interesting, people do not want to save, they want to consume. So it is not inequality of today, but inequality of tomorrow that drives this status-seeking behavior. So people might look very fatalistic because they think they are nowhere in the society. And all of this will have relationships with this one. So basically, and you read Poor Economics or you read Banerjee Duflo's work, I think you would get an idea of what is happening around the world in this context. So I will go straight to credit market and human capital accumulation because that is important, and I will develop the model in little detail because it's basically Galor and Zaida 93, but doing that, it is also telling you that how these models are written. So I could have actually stopped at this solo type of model and give you some verbal description, but I want you to follow. So it's a very simple model. Your income is actually the consumption that you eat and the bequest that you leave for your kids. And your utility is a Cobb-Douglas utility in consumption and bequest. And if you solve this model with a budget constraint, with an income of Y, then you can see your indirect utility would be, utility would be some constant into Y. And what you will do, you will actually put a fraction of your income for your kids and a fraction of income you will eat. And this, putting this bequest for the kids means you are creating a wealth for the kid. You are creating liquidity for the kid. You are creating that KZ for the kid. So human capital, that is, you want to put your kid to education. So X is the inheritance of the kid. Then the kid actually puts in education. Now H is the cost of education. So if your resources are greater than education, educational cost, then what you do, you are basically the, you know, if x is in your inheritance, then 1 minus alpha x, that is, you can see that your bequest would be 1 minus alpha x minus h, because h you will already put in education, and that rest of it you can put it in the bank, earn a fixed deposit interest rate at small r, and then your income would be, when you actually get this education, you become a skilled labor, so you get WS. Your income is, that is how much you have invested in education for your kid, that will go to your kid, and the skill wage that he will earn or she will earn. This is when you are rich enough to pay for the education and you don't have to go to the bank to borrow. And mind you, here the bank also charges a borrowing rate greater than deposit rate. So small I is the borrowing rate, which is greater than small r. Okay. Now, what happens is that you may not be rich enough to pay for education. So you go to the bank and borrow. Now, if you do that, then think in your mind before you look at the equation, at the last equation. So your son or your daughter will get WS, right? But he has to pay this amount that you have borrowed for her. So that would be WS minus the negative bequest that she has received, which is minus 1 minus alpha, then within bracket h minus x, because that's the educational expenses minus what your father had. So it would be WS minus 1 minus alpha into h minus x, which becomes again, and the interest that you pay on that is 1 plus I. So this becomes WS plus 1 minus alpha x minus h, because h minus x was minus, so it is x minus h. So now, for those who have inheritance greater than h, the first bequest is the first path of bequest is the relevant path. For those who have income less than inheritance less than educational expenditure, for them the second path is the proper path. Now, so let us first do this, because there is another path, which is essentially that if you don't get education, we'll also bring to that, that you don't care to get education. So as I said, your indirect utility E into whatever income you end up with. So look at first the USX line. So if you look at first this line, let's look at this line. So if, let's say, if your X is less than H, then it has a slope which is 1 plus I. And beyond H, it has a slope 1 plus R. And 1 plus I is greater than H, so it has two slopes. So up to this, it is 1 plus R. And here, it is 1 plus H. Here, it is 1 plus R. This is 1 plus I. This is 1 plus I, and this is 1 plus R. Now, you have something which is that you chose not to be educated. That this is, you know, you don't want to be educated. Then, of course, you will get a lower wage because as an unskilled worker, and you would get, you know, unskilled worker gets a wage rate for today and you get tomorrow. And tomorrow, actually, the today that you earning, that you earn, that will be added with an interest amount, which is a fixed deposit interest, again, small r. So this path, which is U, that will all through have 1 plus small r, because you are not going to the bank to borrow, you are not paying borrowing rate and so on, but you are, to start with, when you are not getting any skill, you are earning more, because if you don't invest in education, then you don't earn anything. So now you can easily see that those with a level of inheritance which is less than F will not invest in education, and those with more than H will definitely invest in education because they get more utility. And of course, some between F and H, they will also invest in education. So these are the very poor, these are the, let's say, very rich, and this is the middle class. you know, poor, rich, middle class. So the middle class will borrow money from the bank and will invest in education. Actually, so this is basically how the profile will go. So I've said that, note that US line has two slopes. The other line U has slope all through with no investment in education. Up to F, there is no investment. After H, it is the richest section who invests but does not need to borrow. Okay. So now we go to the main diagram of this. That is, if no education, we have said that the utility is E times your income, which is WN in the first period plus WN into 1 plus R, which is WN into 2 plus. Now you can see that I want to know how many people, you know, we need to know the density function of inheritance. That is, at any point of time, at any point of time, I have a distribution of inheritance, right? Like the Z, KZ, Z belong to 0 and 1. So I have a distribution of inheritance, which will determine how many people, after looking at future, after looking at the education cost, how many people are going to invest. And what we are going to show here is that people, there are people of L, let's say, with a distribution from 0 to alpha. It is only those, as we have seen from earlier diagram, that is beyond F, that only those people are going to invest. So I want to find out the distribution between T and alpha, and those will remain unskilled is L minus L of TS. That is people who become skilled. Now you will see that we are doing, what we are doing is actually introducing a non-convexity on the path of skill accumulation, on inheritance accumulation. Or inheritance, as you know, is a fraction of your, or big, is actually, your bequest is a fraction of your income. So it's a path of accumulation of income. So in a way, we have already prepared the forum for discussion, because in the previous case with the ordinary labor market, we talk about how this distribution creates incentive for disincentive for being entrepreneur, and with solo model we have showed how increasing returns creates the possibility of multiple equilibrium. And now what we show how that is, that increasing returns has a foundation. That is, that increasing returns is created by the model. It is not assumed. And this diagram is good enough. So what we are doing here? XT and XT plus one, for this is the two adjacent periods inheritance. You can also say this is present and that is future. And we are worried about present and future. In present, we are here, and in future, after future, will not be there. So let's think of present and future story. And of course, this present and future can evolve because T to T plus 1, T plus 1 to T plus 2, T plus 2 to T plus 3, and so on. And this straight line is a 45 degree line, which says that if I start with some inheritance at period T, then if I just draw this vertical line, it is the equal inheritance next period. So if this is the inheritance I leave, then it goes to the next. So the next period inheritance is also the same. So it's like a steady state. Every period you have the same inheritance. And this is the path, is that up to F, as you remember, up to F, I am not educating myself. So the slope of this line, although this looks almost like parallel, but please excuse me, it has to have a little slope, which is like 1 plus r, small r. After AF, I get educated, but I am a middle class person. I am educated, but I have earned, I need borrowing from the bank. So I have this. I get educated, but the interest rate is I. And then I is greater than r. Then after H, I am a rich person. So I don't go to the bank. So I earn a rate of interest small r on this point. So this is path of my educational achievement as I go along, and how much I actually inherit and how much of it I'm investing. So this looks like a world of multiple equilibrium, with a point here, with a point there, and with a point here. So now suppose let's look at this point, at a point after G, right hand side of G. So I know, I have inherited this XT and I have educated myself, so I can leave inheritance to my next generation up to this level. So this in the next period becomes, you draw this parallel line so that you get the next period your inheritance is greater, because you started with XT, end up with XT plus 1, inheritance is greater, which is exactly this amount because it's 45 degree line. Then again the same process continues. So you go there, 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 and you reach here. So any point to the right, you go to the right, extreme right. So you start from a reasonably affluent person who can actually, even if borrowing from the bank, he has enough with him as X, so that it can leave greater inheritance for the younger people. So you see, between G and H, it is the middle class, which can reach this place. And of course, the rich people will reach this place. And what happens here? Exactly opposite. Not only the poor people, but relatively lower middle class people who are putting money in the bank, money from the bank, getting it from the bank to put money in education. There what happens is, suppose you started with some X, but you leave less for your younger people, younger generation. So your XT plus younger generation. So what happens is, your XT goes here to XT plus 1. Then you leave less. Then you leave even less. And then you reach this equilibrium. So this is like a poverty equilibrium. It's a poverty equilibrium. And this is an unstable equilibrium. So any point below this, you will reach a poverty trap. Any point above this, you will be getting out of poverty trap. And any point here is not very safe. Any little change to the left, it is going to go like this. You see, this kind of unstable equilibrium tells you that you need a big push. So you have to push all these people to here, at least. Now, of course, it is not saying that what you will do with these people. That's different. But if you put everybody after this point, then actually everybody can go here. That is the big message of this one. Now, the lesson of any teaching is to think beyond what you are being taught. If you are taught this model, then you have to then bring in some more interesting doses of realism into this picture and try to tell you, in a sense, to see how you can actually see this is happening in the society, or what kind of things will actually make it happen beyond wealth distribution. It is true that you will have a region like this. People are very poor. They cannot afford to educate. But what goes on between this part and this part, between this part and that part? Because you see, these part between X bar H and H, these two parts can constitute basically the middle class, from a low to an upper segment. And your point is that to push this curve above this, because in any society, this will be there and this will be there. The society wants this region to expand, maybe go here to there. So it is the X bar H to H So one thought experiment for you would be, what are the parametric changes or changes in policies or changes in social intervention that you can expect this range to be bigger? So this is one thing that you should think. Now, credit market imperfection, as we have said, fewer entrepreneurs, less demand for workers, lower wage poverty inequality. The same thing here, less human capital, less educated workers, lower wage poverty and inequality. Inequality leads to further inequality with efficiency consequence. Because if you start from a very unequal society, eventually your society will not grow because people will not be educated, because you will not have entrepreneurs. And there is a relationship between equity and efficiency. So if you have a very efficient society, you can be very unequal society. India has been growing at a rate of 5 to 6% over the last decades, or even beyond that. China has been growing at more than 7%, maybe for ages. But inequality is big in both countries. So faster growth may imply inequality. But whether inequality has an impact on growth, that is also a very interesting question. And there is a literature which shows that inequality breeds factors which lead to low growth and then higher inequality. So inequality propagates inequality. And one type of literature is this idea of credit market imperfection. The other type of literature comes through the political economy literature of democracy, you know, the book by Parson and Tabellini, who have studied mostly Western democracies, in which, so that's Western democracies, in which they discuss that through median voter theorem, that if you are very unequal, then actually voters should always like the government, you know, not to give tax breaks to the capitalist. And therefore private sector won't invest that much. And therefore growth rate will suffer. Now that type of logic in some ways, you know, can be easily challenged in this country, of course, but political economic argument cannot be denied altogether. Because the government will not engage in public investment that much. If you have an unequal society where you have to give lots of, you know, supports, income supports in the current period, government has much less to invest. And so inequality, people might not want the government to invest a lot because the outcomes will come much later in future. The government will not have incentive because the outcomes will come much later, beyond when they are no longer, you know, eligible to become politicians or become political leaders. So all of this and the electoral complexities would lead to bias in favor of expenditure, which does not look at, let's say, you know, that's why in our country, education to GDP ratio is, education expenditure is not good. The quality of education, actually monitoring and regulating the quality and issues like that are still very open-ended and not great. So all of this will have a bearing on equity efficiency relation, equity growth relation. But credit market imperfection is visibly and financially are very compelling in some sense. So that's why we study this. And so does initial asset distribution necessarily affect production in the credit intensive sector? So these things we are going to talk about now, implications on trade and inequality and product market imperfections and so on. And the sections that I have given you, you can, you know, there are plenty of papers, you know, like Banerjee Duflo's Poor Economics book, their 1992 paper, which that referred to in their 2005 work, I think, Handbook of Economic Growth, Gallo and Ziera's work, and Mukherjee and Ray, you know, I think, and of course, Debraj's textbook and Kaushik Basu's textbook, because Debraj Rai's textbook will have a section on this labor market and bank borrowing. So he actually says that or puts a very simple model for undergrads, but I think it's very, very insightful, that how, you know, low wage means low wage, because you have more low wage, low wealth, many employees, less employer, and so on. Whereas Kaushik Basu's book actually demonstrates Gallo-Ziera in a very interesting way, very simple way. So I have used Kaushik Basu's book. So these are the references. So now we will go to lecture 2. And this is a work, or this is something which is undertaken very recently. Actually, this speaks about how we may have... very interesting consequences of government policy of redistribution. Hello? On
Excuse me, sir?
Credit market, on production, on international trade, and on international capital flows. This is more like a research paper, how wealth distribution affects entrepreneurship, pattern of trade, and capital flows in a relatively poor economy with credit rationing. See, what we are trying to do in this work is basically we are trying to find out that government is actively engaged in redistribution, so that we have found that it is the existing distribution of wealth that is creating all this problem. So now what we are doing is that we are looking at policies that is talking about redistribution. And we are trying to look at very carefully on how this redistribution policy can happen and what kind of consequences it will happen depending on how you are actually conducting these policies in the context of an economy which looks like India, which looks like India. And this is based on some papers, not papers, but the background paper, I would say. The background paper is one which is a paper by myself and Ron Jones in 2001 American Economic Review, which is on how you can envisage the role of credit market in the context of development process. Then Antras and Caballero in their JPE paper in 2014 on international trade and credit market frictions, and Von Hagen and Zhang in 2014 Journal of Development Economics. And they talk about various aspects of trade and flows. So some of them, like Zhang and Von Hagen and Antras and Caballero, they discuss how skewed distribution can lead to interesting relationship between trade and capital flows. And skewed distribution is what we are mentioning here. There was a Lucas paradox in 1990, and then paper by Alfero, who actually reviews these papers and writes another paper, why capital flows away from poor countries to rich countries. You see, in economics, our basic sense is, in the marginal productivity world of economics with which we all grow up, the basic idea is that West has more capital, or the North has more capital, so the rate of return is lower. South has less capital, so the rate of return to capital is higher. Therefore, capital will flow from the North to the South. And the fact that Lucas in 1990 wrote this very interesting paper, why capital does not flow from north to south that easily. And he talked about human capital. He said that basically there are externalities. So why so many brilliant people actually flock to America? Because they can work with brilliant people like themselves. So if you do that, then actually you get a positive effect of externality. So what happens is people, you know, if there is more human capital in our country, in a country, then actually the return from further human capital actually increases. So if this is the case, it is like a convexity, because you have more something, then actually increases the marginal return of additional unit. And in that case, what would happen that, you know, more human capital will flow into that country, and where you have less human capital, then the human capital will not stay in that country. So that is basically the idea, that why, you know, very talented people will like to roam around very talented people. You know, when things are happening at some place, like when innovations are happening around you, you can be far more innovative than when innovations are not happening. And however talented and however gifted you are not actually, you know, you are not interacting with people of equal abilities, or people with similar abilities and similar visions and so on. So low supply of capital and credit forces country to import capital intensive goods. Now, what we are going to show here is similar kind of a result, but completely of a different reason. We are trying to show, or we will show, that rate of return to capital can be lower in a country like India, because there is far less demand for capital than what you have in the West, given the same amount of capital stock, because there is far less demand, because there is fewer entrepreneurs. So if entrepreneurs are not there, then as if your capital, you know, demand for capital is much less. So if the demand for capital is much less, the return, the price of capital would be much less. And a capital owner would like to go to a country where price of capital is high. Because after all, price of capital is the discounted value or present discounted value of the rates of return to capital. So if your price of capital is low, your rates of return from capital is low. And in fact, here we do not talk about price of capital, we talk about returns to capital. This is a very simple point we like to make. And we then like to make a point that if the government thinks that egalitarian distribution or redistribution is going to solve the problem, it may not. So we also reflect on, and why I'm actually speaking all those things, because it gives the essence of our ideas that we are going to present to you. And basically, so unlike standard policy prescriptions in the presence of credit rationing, we argue redistribution from the top to the rich, top the rich to the bottom of the poor aggravates the problem. Very different from, you know, this literature and so on, and that I don't want to give the paper as a seminar paper, so I'm going to give it as a more like a lecture. So I'm not going to talk a lot about all these papers and so on. So let me go straight to the model, because then so what do we have here? We have a country, we call it a small economy. What is a small economy? It can actually produce a good and sell in the rest of the world at a going prices. The price is determined in the rest of the world. I cannot do anything about the price. I can only produce. That's it. And how do I produce? By the same logic that I have developed. I need to borrow from the bank and my own capital and make sure. So what I do, I actually borrow some amount. And again, my KZ is ranked accordingly, you know, as I have said earlier. So I can borrow from the bank. And if I borrow from the bank, and let's say that one unit of finance give me one unit of output. So I can actually, you know, I am a worker, basically, inherently a worker. I go to the bank, I have some wealth. I go to the bank gives me some loan. Then I take that loan and produce output. So there I am an entrepreneur. I employ people. One unit of labor requires one unit of output to produce. I employ people who want to be want to be workers, and I produce. So when I have borrowed this much from the bank and I'm earning per unit of output P, then P minus capital R is my surplus, my profit from my borrowed finance from the bank. P minus small r is my price for my surplus that I return from my own capital. And this is my, basically, you know, actually this would be, there is a KZ missing here, but anyway, doesn't matter. But what I do, I will only invest if my income from engaging in production is greater than my income from the return to capital and wage rate. So here what is happening here, you know, you can just, because this is basically, you know, you would be like, if I don't put in this, we're missing some points here. This is a typo, I think, still not corrected. Is R of, you know, it's plus the wage rate that I can get as an employee. You know, if you consider this constraint, look, what is this constraint? This is, I have already taken my opportunity cost, which is R of KZ. I have taken it to the left. So what I do is, if I earn some return because I can invest my wage that I'm earning W as a worker. So I would have a component of W here, which is missing here. But the capital that is actually I am putting in my own capital in production, right? I am actually accounting for that. So I could have written P minus R BZ plus P of KZ greater than equal to R of KZ plus R times W, suppose, which is missing here. So with that, and of course, this will tell you that greater is my, you know, because we have already understood why your BZ will depend on KZ because of this default constraint. And here the default constraint looks little different from the earlier model, because when there is a penalty, when you read these slides, you can just check. He has entered my account. So bank is not only charging my penalty on KZ, but whatever BZ I'm left with or whatever it is. So that will tell you this kind of a maximum borrowing kind of condition. However, if that is not the case, then this Q theta will not appear here, and it becomes exactly equal to what I have done before in my earlier slides. So you substitute this here and you make it equal. And then you can assume that I measure everything in terms of the wage rate, because W is the wage rate. So if I take that as a numerator, then it does not matter. So I measure everything according to the wage rate. So price, rate of interest, everything is measured in terms of that wage rate, because you know this is a real side of the story. So it is like a relative price, and I can do that because you know there is labor market and there is commodity market, and by Walras law, if the commodity market clears, the labor market will clear because there is no unemployment. Okay, so we can then figure out what is the critical minimum K I should have that I will be an entrepreneur. This is exactly like, it's an elaborate way of saying the same thing as I have said in my first lecture. So here, let me explain something. Small r is a deposit rate. Capital R is the borrowing rate. And I assume that the borrowing rate is a markup over the deposit rate. And it is a competitive markup. So there is banks in the competitive banks, but that they are allowed, this is like a collusive markup they take. And the banking thing here is I'm not ignoring banks altogether, but I'll be concentrating on the commodity market. And since this is a competitive market, I will presume there are a certain number of banks who are charging some rate of interest. That's it. And they are willing to give credit to the intermediate. So credit, again, there is a credit market. So there is a commodity market, credit market, and labor market. And I'll be focusing on commodity market and credit market. And I'm not going to consider the competition or market structure of banks. That is how this capital R is being determined. I'm keeping it as a black box. I'm just assuming that there is a markup. Now, there can be a story of oligopoly there. There is no problem with that. But that is irrelevant for the results that I want to show you. So mu r, mu greater than 1, tells you that capital R is greater than R. And this is the critical, you know, capital stock. That is, we have already talked about the default rate and so on, etc. So that's the critical thing. So now, KZ is, as we know, it's upward rising, because Z to Z1, 0 to 1, you know, these are the richer people. So there is a critical level of Z tilde, below which people will not become entrepreneurs, they will be workers, and above Z tilde will be entrepreneurs. So I can look at the production of X. X is the product that requires credit, and Y is a product that does not require credit. So Y is like a, you know, that if I don't become, you know, I go into X, I can produce Y, which I can get an instantaneous production. You know, it's not important. Y is brought here because I would like to understand the implications of trade, because, you know, you have a naturally credit intensive good, because if Y does not have a credit or capital that is being used, X becomes a capital intensive, a credit intensive good naturally, because this credit intensity relative to Y is infinite, because Y, for Y it is zero. And Y is by definition the labor intensive good. What is my total xz? Is the integral between z tilde and 1. There is a 1 somewhere here. So z tilde and 1, and this is bz plus kz, and since bz is a function of kz, so we could substitute that, and z tilde is a function of p as well as return to as well as borrowing or lending interest rate, actually the borrowing rate, but since mu is constant, I'm not bringing in mu here. So p and small r. So this is the total amount of x that is produced, and total amount of y is that xz tilde of y. So xz tilde is the total number out of total production of output, and basically those who are not employed, because every, if a z tilde people are there to be employed. So if z tilde people are there, the total labor force, if they are not employed in x, they must be employed in y. So the z tilde minus x z tilde, because one unit of x requires one unit of labor. So that is there. So this is the relative supply. And you can check that as z tilde goes down, your xz will go up, so the relative supply will go up. Because z tilde going down means lesser workers and more entrepreneurs. So if the lesser workers, then there is lower amount of y. So xz tilde by y actually increases if there are more entrepreneurs. Now, this is the supply side of the model. We assume a homothetic demand function. As you know always, that the homothetic demand function is function only of the relative price. The ratio of this relative demand is equal to the ratio of the relative price. So the income size does not matter in terms of, you know, a bias in terms of consumption. So income size does not matter. So this is the relative price. So relative demand must be equal to relative supply, which means D has to be equal to S in equilibrium. So that is 6. Okay, so let me just, so here, therefore, z tilde as a function of p and r, you can see that. And s is a function of p and r. Therefore, s is nothing but actually z tilde by y. So it's a function of p and r. Demand is a function of p. So automatically, we'll see given r, I can solve for p. Because once I know what is the lending rate, borrowing rate, whatever, I know how much is production, how much is demand, I know. So I can solve for a P in equilibrium. Similarly, if I know what is P, I can solve for an R, the small r. Right? Because 6 is an equation with two unknowns. So we are now going to talk about determination of both P and R by equilibrium condition, or through the equilibrium conditions of the commodity market, which is 6, and then we will have another condition for the credit market. So R and P determined from P, which is F of R. That is, for different levels of R, I can take a P, which is equilibrating the commodity market. Now, this is almost, the exercise is the same as ISLM. It's not, but don't confuse it with the ISLM model. That is, you have an IS equation where, you know, if the R changes, how Y changes so that the commodity market is in equilibrium, and R changes and how Y changes so that the LM curve tells you how the money market is in equilibrium. But here, it is not the same thing how the credit market is equilibrium. Because mind you, the guys who are between 0 to Z tilde time, R, they have savings. It is not our earlier model, but by assumption we say that no, they don't have anything, any wealth. Each of them has wealth. And if the bank has no other people, so these, the poor people, but lot many of them possibly, you know, because there may be many of them. So that is the supply of capital or credit that goes to the bank. And this is the demand for credit. That is the output produced in the credit sector, credit intensive sector. So those who are workers are actually giving money to those who are entrepreneurs. So the entrepreneurs are taking their money and also money of the poor people. This is a classic example of banking system in the underdeveloped countries or developing countries or India. That is, all the low income, middle income, and reasonably poor people put their money in public sector banks. And all the big private corporate sectors use this money for investment. Because they take the risk, they have the technology. Maybe they are much more talented and gifted than the poor people and middle class and others. You know, I do not know, but that's possible. They need resources. So they are the ones who are taking risk. They are the ones who are Schumpeterian, you know, spearheaders, the leaders. But this is the story everywhere. Formal sector banking, the public, and this is the different story in microfinance. It is the poor who is sometimes serving the poor. But people say that you graduate into banking system. Of course, you also have aspirations to get into the proper formal sector. Grameen Bank is an example. Bandhan Bank is an example. So what you have here, that poor people are putting their money in fixed deposits, and the dynamic entrepreneurs who also have higher wealth, they are putting their money into business. And that's how your small r will be determined. And then the bank will charge a mu times small r as their return. So for every r, I can have a p. For every p, I have a r. Now, let me just, because look at the equation here. Suppose I increase r. If I increase r, you know, there'll be less entrepreneurs, no doubt about that. Because you go to my borrowing constraint thing, increase in R means that maximum amount of borrowing will fall. So people would earn less, and people would earn less means they can actually, people will earn less, which means that they will be less, you know, inclined to be entrepreneurs. So less output of X would be produced. So there will be less entrepreneurs, so less output is produced. So the point is what we are saying, if less output is produced, then supply goes down and the P goes up. So higher R, less output, higher P. So you need higher P to clear the market, right? So we have an upward rising relationship between R and P in the commodity market. What about credit market? In credit market, if you increase P, then you can, from the capital, this thing, you know, the equation which determines Z tilde, you know, maybe the equation, you can just have a look. Look at this equation, number one. Higher P means more people want to be entrepreneurs. So Z tilde actually falls. Z tilde falls means people want more credit. They want to be entrepreneurs. They want to borrow. But there will be fewer workers to supply capital to the bank. They all have become entrepreneurs now. I mean, most of, well, many of them or few of them. So credit demand is increasing, credit supply is falling. So R is going to increase. So these two taken together, I'm running. So CC is upward rising the commodity market equilibrium. KK is upward rising the credit market equilibrium. Now you can prove that this is a stable model. That is, you allow P to adjust along CC and allow R to adjust along KK, because this is an upward, two upward rising curves. So CC curve is flatter than KK, because then if you start from outside the equilibrium, it would come here. Because suppose you are credit, in credit market equilibrium. Suppose credit market is in equilibrium. So you are here, some P and R which, for which the credit market is equilibrium, but commodity market is not there. So P will adjust. P will adjust immediately because P is too high, which means there is excess supply. So P falls. Then you come to commodity market equilibrium. But then you are not on credit market equilibrium. So your credit market, you have much higher R, which means credit supply is much bigger. So credit supply has to fall. So you come to the credit market. R has to fall because R has to adjust on KK. And that way you come to this equilibrium. Similarly, from here you go there. But if this was CC and this was KK, the exactly opposite, you have an unstable equilibrium. So that's the reason we have done it. Now we come to the main question of the paper, which is, suppose now there is redistribution of wealth. So there is a policy by which government redistributes. Now I have referred to this other paper because we discussed this redistribution process, how this leads to efficiency, inefficiency, and how that leads to inequality and so on in our other paper with Beladi and Oladi. But here is the international trade and capital flow aspect of it. So there, so most of the papers are discussed, you know, there in terms of how, what is efficiency, what is inefficiency, and so on, and how the inequality actually increases with some redistribution and inequality decreases with some distribution. And this paper focuses on the open economic aspect of it. So that's why they are distinct. So there are two examples here. One example is, I am taking away this much of capital and giving it to this much of people, and I'm taking away this much of capital and giving away to this much of people. Now, what is the, why I'm calling it efficient, it is inefficient? Because if I give this much of capital to this much, to this number of people, and redraw the curve, so redraw the curve is this, then it goes like that, then it redraws like that, which means the cutoff point does not change. Because these people are not becoming entrepreneurs. If these people are not becoming entrepreneurs, then actually you are taking productive capital and giving to people who are not going to use it as productive capital. And therefore, X output will fall and P will rise. So you wanted to create more entrepreneurs, but instead you are creating less entrepreneurs. You know, there are fewer entrepreneurs. Now, again, I shall come back in the end saying that how this differs from the way we think, and then we'll see that they are not very different, but we'll talk about that. Now here the situation is different, because if I give this much of capital to this much of people, then there is a neighborhood of people where Z tilde will fall, there'll be more entrepreneurs, because now these guys who are near to the cutting point, they will be entrepreneurs. And if they become entrepreneurs, then your X production might increase. And of course, you have to compare this with this, but you can actually do some redistribution by increasing number of entrepreneurs, provided you are not giving to those who are actually cannot become entrepreneurs. So in that case, you have different impacts on outputs. So then what happens? Let's look at here. So this C1, C1 initial curve, and there, and K1, K1 was the initial curve. So we had P1 and R1 as initial equilibrium. Now what has happened? C2, the new curve is C2, because for any R, now P has increased. This is I'm talking about the inefficient redistribution. So any R, P has increased. Now, if that is so, that means your demand, your total out, because there is, you know, in a sense, there are less output in the system. If there is less output, people don't want to produce that much of output, then there is less demand for capital. So R must fall. So K1, K1 curve shift to the left. For the same P, the R will fall. So one possible equilibrium is P2 and R2. Now there can be other equilibria where your K2, K2 can change a little less and so on. So you can have a little shift in K1, and then there is P2, R2 may actually be here, etc. But there is a purpose why I am saying that this is going to happen. And in fact, if K1, K1 jumps a lot, then actually there is a chance that R, you know, basically R2 has to fall from R1. Now that is the critical point. I'm saying that because, you know, why this is happening? Because your demand for credit is less. Because if you are taxing productive entrepreneurs, you know, by some process and giving that transfer to those of course, it's from inequality perspective, it's a better policy. So here, inequality is leading to, you know, equality, relative equality, because you're giving to those who do not have it. So equality is leading to inefficiency. On the other hand, the other type of distribution, equality leads to efficiency, because you can create more and more entrepreneurs. Now, if that is the case, then two things actually happen. You have it, now you consider a country which is more egalitarian. That is a country which is C2K2, and a country which is less egalitarian, which is C1K1. So there are two countries where everything else is the same. Everything else. So two countries have nothing in different, because that's how you actually analyze the strength of a model, because two countries are identical in every respect, but the government policies are different. So one government loves equity and pursues a policy that we are talking about, that is, it has given, taking the tax from the some middle income entrepreneurs, let's say, and given it to a very, very poor set of people. Then that country is given by C2K2, and the other country is given by C1K1. And these two countries, to start with, are in isolation. They are in isolation. They are two countries. But now they are opening up. So these two countries are contemplating to engage in trade and capital flows. So what is going to happen here? Country one would have a lower amount of lower P1 and a higher R1. And country two will have a higher P2 and lower R2, lower R. Now, why this is happening? Because in country one, it is less egalitarian. So that's the benchmark. Country two is more egalitarian. So there are fewer entrepreneurs, and P1 is higher, so it's P2. And there is very little demand for capital because there are not entrepreneurs. So the return to capital is lower. Now compare this with the way we understand the basic trait theory. Whenever we look at the definition of physical abundance or physical definition of factor abundance or price definition of factor abundance, and we don't consider demand side, that is demand for output and so on. Here also the demand for output does not matter. You know, they are all the same, and actually everything is the same. Now what is happening? My country may have a lower amount of capital than your country. But in my country, or maybe the same amount of total wealth, you know, total capital means total wealth. But in my country, there are fewer entrepreneurs. So capital does not have too much of a demand. So rate of return is lower. It is not because I'm capital abundant. That's why it is lower. And in the other country, we may have same capital, but people really need a lot of capital. There are more entrepreneurs. So it can produce more output. So what happens? I am producing less output, which is true because I don't have so much of people producing X, and credit, this is not, you know, credit, there is not much demand for credit, but I'm a poor country. The other country is not so egalitarian, but that country producing more X and has a capital return which is higher because there's too much demand for capital. So then the main, you know, I'm not going to talk about all the results, it's all 11:30 now. The main result is, suppose we allow for capital to trade, that is, banks, there are two sets of banks in each country, and the banks want to go from one country to the other, or the people, the workers want to put their funds somewhere else, they will always go to that country which has higher amount of rate of return to capital, higher rate of return to capital. So a credit, so what is happening here? Credit supply will go down in this country because they will go here. And if this happens, then credit supply goes down in this country, right? So more people would like to invest there in the country. So capital will flow from more egalitarian to less egalitarian country. It is not only a question of north and south. It is not that if you have wealth, less of wealth, you have, of course you will have produced less X. So I am neutralizing that. We are neutralizing that. So what has happened here is that we have a type of a distribution where, you know, it is possible that we are trying to do well because of the social welfare. We are trying to, so this, why this is, you know, there have been schemes in this country where from time to time government announces that I'll give you collateral free loan of this much amount of money, collateral free loan, or you can give, you know, this has happened in many states at the government level, at the central government, that you can give money to people. You know, come, there would be some sort of a give away of certain amount of money. You know, people take that money and they can eat it up because they don't have prerequisite infrastructure, prerequisite knowledge, prerequisite technology, prerequisite anything. So for that, they need even extra amount of wealth, you know, whatever it is. Then they will eat it up and they will not pay it. And they know that in some, you know, some time their loan can be waived also. So, you know, I'm not going to the loan waiver issue, you know, how people, government is conducting their policy. That's not my business. But the fact is, always redistribution does not give efficient outcome. Now, when it can and it cannot, does it depend on the product market? That would be my last part. Because here, if you look at the theory of it, everybody is using every penny that they are getting from the bank. Now, one case I have not discussed in this paper that is being discussed, let's say in Galor-Zyra model, that there are people who have so much of wealth that they don't need money from the bank, or they don't want to put in their money from the bank in production, but they took money from the bank as credit. But the point is that banks want to give them credit, but they don't want so much of credit. So banks have given an implicit quota that if big guys like, you know, maybe Reliance Company or Tata's or Wipro or Mahindra or you name it, Birla's and so on, you know, they probably need, let's say, $10 million as loan. But banks are willing to give them 20 million. So their demand for loan is 10, but they have a kitty of loan, which is 20. So this 10 million, the bank wants to give them. But if I want or you want or somebody little less than them want, they don't give it to them. Because they think he does not have sufficient wealth that they can put penalty or do something or whatever. Then what happens is there is excess supply of loan. If you take that from those people and give it to poor people, you know, who can invest, that is definitely efficient. Because fast redistribution will generate efficiency. But if even those people, you know, bank wants to give them 20 million and Tata's have only 120 million, then if you take 10 million from the bank or from the Tata's, that's wrong. So why Tata's, Reliance and everybody, they would like to, they may not actually produce much, but charge a very high price and make profit from there. They don't produce, you know, here all the entrepreneurs can get more profits if they produce more because the price is frozen. They are small. But if your entrepreneurs are big, they can influence price. So by carteling quantity, they can influence price. So what would that happen? And I'll just give you one example. Look at this example. This is a very generic example. It says price is equal to, you know, price is a markup on marginal cost. This is marginal revenue equal to marginal cost condition for a monopolist. P is, you know, MR equal to P into 1 minus 1 by elasticity. So the P is equal to marginal cost, that is R, which is R mu, capital R, divided by 1 minus 1 by epsilon. Epsilon, when it is infinite, then it is, you know, really competitive. So P equal to capital R. And we have kept that the idea that because, you know, each guy can make profit because each guy has some wealth. So I can make more profit than you because I have more wealth than you and I get more credit than you. So competitive world but different profit rates is happening because of the wealth heterogeneity or asset heterogeneity. Here it's a pure competitive model, that is this particular model. If your epsilon is lower, you know your price should be higher because the degree of monopoly increases. Less substitute it is, the monopolist will charge more price, or this might be a collusive price among the firms which are at the top bracket of this wealth heterogeneity, and they will charge very high price. So in that case, you may have an equilibrium. You know, this is your relationship between price and R by that equation. And this is the KK curve. Remember that we have said. So the equilibrium might be somewhere here because no longer you are in the CC line because we are outside the competitive equilibrium, thinking of a monopoly. Then your R would be higher, P would also be higher. As P would be higher, demand for credit would be higher. So in a way, what happens is that, so it's like, which I'm not developing here, it's like a leadership model. The leader set the prices and then the price goes to the people. So in that case, in an economy, you have both high P and high R. So this economy in this model, when you actually allow for these kind of economies to trade, then the capital will start coming in. So we should be careful about when we read about capital flows, because it is possible that actually capital may flow from poor country to a rich country. Because in the rich country, the credit demand is much more. And the fact is that people might say, oh, but India receives foreign investment. So, you know, in general, foreign investment comes from the rich to poor countries. Now, I am giving you these first three are empirical implications and possible testable hypothesis, but you know, Gini coefficient might be a degree of inequality thing, but actually building up a very good econometric work on this requires a lot of good data, because you have to mix and match data on entrepreneurship, how important credit is entrepreneurship, how important is your own money on getting capital, what is the role of microfinance, why microfinance is not flourishing in the formal sector that much, why formal sector is not into informal banking, all because there is no informal banking in my model, which I think is a very interesting part, and it is an open question, and this paper should be extended to bring in informal sector, because that's where, you know, there you can get the cutoff point little lower, you know, that because some people, if they don't get into formal sector because they don't have collateral, they can go to the informal sector. But still there would be people who will not be entrepreneurs because they may not have that kind of talent, gift, technology, knowledge, you know, information and so on and so forth. So bringing in formal sector solves this model a little bit. But again, capital does not flow to informal sector. It has to flow to the formal sector. And bringing informal sector make the rate of return to capital even, you know, kind of less to whatever they have. So one does not know. Now, the recorded levels of outwardly capital flow is very small in the developing countries. But new research shows that trade misinvoicing camouflages actual and illegal capital outflows. You know, we have this notion of low capital, you know, outwardly flow, but we have always shouted about how billions of dollars go to the Swiss bank. Now, yes, it's a tax evaded money. I understand. But the question is, I can give, you know, you should look at IMF 7th Annual Statistical Forum. We just ended last year in 2009. I think the website you can access. And there I have discussed on informal capital flows from India to US. And I'll give you, I'll just end this story by a simple empirical observation, which is right. That India, in many cases, are on the different sides of capital flows, but USA might be receiving much more capital flows than what India is what is being reported to Reserve Bank, and India, in some sense, when you, even capital comes from USA to India. So it's like very interesting because capital from Mauritius to US to India, that is, the flows are highly overreported, and it's not done for some countries. And the fact is that there is, if you allow for capital to go, you know, when we did not have this face off with China and so on, you know, as long as you allow for competitive trading, many Indians will go out and set up business in China, like the Americans have done. The Americans have actually set up huge businesses in China, but you know, it's possible that the returns in China in are higher than India, not because that the China has lower amount of capital, but because China has a huge amount of capital, because the credit the credit market expands there, so that there is a lot of entrepreneurs that they need more investment. So it is, you know, one does not know how exactly you get an international sort of evidence on this, that's sort of for future research. But the idea that lower rate of return to capital is not only a signal of higher supply of capital, it might be a signal for lower demand for capital. And that might happen when your credit market is imperfect and entrepreneurs are less, and there is a heterogeneity of wealth distribution, skewed wealth distribution. And whether you would look for a more equal policy, that has to happen with the structure of distribution and the product market, to see how many people, how many entrepreneurs are not utilizing the loans banks are willing to pay. That will also tell them how much wealth tax you have to impose. So these are some of the issues, I think, that one can open up for discussion. So thank you, and that's the end of my lecture.